No artist has come to define a genre of music quite the way Bob Marley has come to define reggae music. In fact, in many ways, Bob has transcended music altogether and become a pop culture icon. He emerged as the first third world hero, giving a voice to the oppressed and really speaking for the downtrodden across the world. Many would call him a revolutionary genius, a romantic, and a spiritual prophet. He was taken from us far too early, at the age of only 36 years old, but he's left behind a huge legacy of music. In this video today, I'm going to attempt to rank Bob Marley's Island studio albums from worst to best. And in doing so, I didn't use any sort of formulas, ranking songs, or anything to this nature. I simply considered each album as its own artistic creation and tried to feel what the vibe I received from those albums were and considered the significance of the albums as well. In future videos, I may go back and do the pre-Island catalog and maybe look at some of the live albums and box sets that have come out over the years. But for now, we're focusing in on the Island studio albums. Let's get to it. Coming in at number 9, we have Confrontation. This is the posthumous album from Bob Marley, released in May 1983, 2 years after his death in 81. I think it speaks to the amount of effort that they put into making this album. It was overseen by Chris Blackwell and the I3s, and of course brought in the Wailers Band as well. The themes and kind of tone of the album was set by Bob Marley well before his death. It was the third in a series of albums that dealt with sort of really political, social, conscious rising kind of themes. The first being Survival, then followed by Uprising, and then Confrontation. That's reflected here on the cover where you have Bob Marley on the horse with the spear slaying the dragons of Babylon. I did a kind of a look at this cover previously, so I'll link it up here somewhere. That theme continues on inside the album as well, inside the gatefold, I should say, where you have the Battle of 1896, where the Italians invaded Ethiopia and the Ethiopians held them off. And so that gives you an idea of the themes, and that themes continued musically throughout the album as well. Now, Something had to go last, and there's just a few songs on here that I don't really like, or they don't really resonate with me. As opposed to the rest of Bob Marley's catalog, I think I like every song on every album. So this was an easy pick for me. What are the songs on here that I think are misses? Well, we have songs like Mix Up, Mix Up. A really kind of busy song. It's all over the place. I don't really know what it's about. Kind of a confusing song. And there's songs like Stiff-Necked Fool and I Know, where you've got, you know, the synthesizer coming in on Stiff-Necked Fool, which was the way reggae music was kind of going in the 1980s, but just not my favorite era of reggae music, I guess. And also really overproduced, I think, I Know. You know, it's soulful and it's got a nice opening section, but, you know, overproduced, not great. But that's not to say this album isn't worth having. There are some absolute great songs on here, so definitely worth adding to your collection. The opening track, Chant Down Babylon, is just a great opener. And you'll hear me talk about openers and closers with Bob Marley albums throughout this video, because he knew the art of the album, and this is just one more example of that. One More Time, Come We Go Chant Down Babylon One More Time, being the last album. That's a great opener, right? One Last Celebration with Bob, One Last Time to Burn All Pollution and Speak Truth to Power, right? So that's good. It goes right in after that to Buffalo Soldier, which is probably the best known track. Speaks of the African people being taken from Africa, brought to America, fighting on arrival, fighting for survival, kind of shedding light on a really little known part of American history where the black soldiers were fighting with the U.S. cavalry against the indigenous population. Jump Night Binga is a good song. You know, Trench Town is okay. Black Man Redemption is a stellar track. Great, great arrangements on here. Really great horn section. The rhythm section is fire on all cylinders. And the I3 have some really nice vocals on here as well. And then the album ends with a really great closer as well. Rasta Man Live Up. Absolutely great. You know, it's kind of the song of the underdog saying, you know, we will prevail. Keep on fighting. Don't give up. And what a great message to end when Bob Marley has passed and his fans are left to continue not giving up and continuing the battle. And from here on in, it gets a lot more challenging to rank these albums because I really, really like each and every one of them. So I guess on any particular day, I'm depending on how I feel, might go up a place or two or down a place or two. But today, at number 8, we have Survival. Survival was the first in the chain of 3 kind of highly political albums from Bob Marley, as I mentioned earlier. And yeah, I think that's probably why it gets ranked a little lower. It's not, you know, it's not my go-to Bob Marley album. You know, there's no love song on here, and I like Bob Marley's love songs. There are some danceable tracks and really groovers, but it just kind of lacks the completeness, I guess. It's almost a concept album in its themes. So what are the themes? Well, it was 1979, and things in Jamaica politically weren't getting any better. You know, in some ways, they were getting worse. Bob Marley recently went to Africa for the very first time. And ideas of Pan-Africanism and African unity began to dominate, or at least take a much more central role, even more so than they were on previous albums. And that comes through in spades here. You can see from the cover artwork with the African flags on here to the drawing of the slave ship, which continues in on the inner sleeve as well. This was, I guess, instructions for how to pack slaves optimally on the slave ship. So that's the kind of content you're going to be getting on Survival. And you see some imagery on the backs. Marcus Garvey quote here. So what are the tracks here that really stand out to me? So again, it's got great openers and closers. It starts off with So Much Trouble, great opener, really sets the theme, kind of outlining all the troubles in the world. We go into Zimbabwe, kind of prophetic because the country hadn't changed its name to Zimbabwe yet. They hadn't gained their independence. They soon would, and Bob would perform at the independence ceremony. Top ranking, one of my favorite tracks on the album. Great horn section here. Perfect example, I think, of how Bob can still be highly political and yet move us on the dance floor, right? Just a really groovy tune, talking about, you know, promoting unity and so forth. Babylon System, putting a mirror up to society, calling out hypocrisies, and then the really anthemic title track, Survival. It's got that hook that na 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 that is just infectious, right? So a great way to close side A, keep you wanting more, get up, flip that record over, and then you've got Africa Unite, kind of an uplifting beat and a hopeful message, followed by One Drop. Again, really nice feeling song, kind of laid back, but yet quite serious in its thematic subject matter. Ride, Natty Ride. Again, we have great horns on this one as well. The I3s have some really great vocal performances on here. Fire burning down Babylon. Rasta Man will ride through the storm. Yeah? Then we go on to Ambush, which is talking about political violence and the attempted assassination on Bob Marley back in 76, was it? And the album ends with Wake Up and Live, which again is a great closer. Very danceable, nice horns on here again. Rise, ye mighty people, there's work to be done, so let's do it little by little. So great album, despite that, maybe a little bit more serious in tone, so it gets comes in today at my number 8 spot. And coming in at number 7, we have Uprising. Uprising was the second in that 3-part series that I've been talking about. And so very political in nature, like the previous two I've been discussing, and probably why it gets a little bit lower than some of the other albums. But yet, some of my favorite Bob Marley tracks of all time appear on this album. So we open up with Coming In From the Cold. A great opening track. It's light, it's airy, a bit of a spiritual message, at least that's how I interpret it. Just a great opener. We then go into Real Situation, which talks about war and conflict. It says, "No one can stop them now. Don't even try. The only solution, total destruction." That's heavy, right? We then go into Bad Cars, kind of bit the day-to-day, the rat race, and how, music can help lift you up. And then we go into We and Them, which is a good track. I like the rhythm on here. How are we going to work it out? Kind of talking about how we're going to work together. I think, this song leads right into the next, almost like question and then the answer is work, right? Ja people can make it work. Work. We got some work for you. Yeah, so we got to work it out, right? Rasta is going to help. So I think, side A has, it's a really good sound quality on here. I think that the production value is great. The previous album, Survival, the only Island album that Chris Blackwell wasn't involved in the production. And I think here you can hear that production value kind of standing out a little bit more. That said, it is still a bit of a slog to get through side A. Side B, I think, is a little bit more in my liking, I suppose. It starts off with Zion Train, which is really kind of a hypnotic song with kind of a spiritual undertones, overtones, I suppose, the spiritual in nature. Some nice guitar licks on here, and the I3s are doing great. You got a ticket. Get on the Zion Train, baby. We then go into Pimper's Paradise. Every need's got an ego to feed. Don't lose track of yourself. Don't be stock on the shelf. Yeah, get talking to the women of Jamaica, really, or the women of the world, I suppose. And like on the side A, where you had a kind of question and answer, I kind of think this is the same here with Pimper's Paradise going right into Could You Be Loved, which is, again, one of my favorite Bob Marley tracks of all time. Just an amazing message. Amazing rhythm, in the darkness, there must come out to light. Just a fantastic song. If you don't know Could You Be Loved, check it out. It's infectious. And then we've got Forever Loving Ja, which has some beautiful arrangements on here. The percussions, rather, really stand out on this one. And then we end with one of my all-time favorites as well, Redemption Song. You might not even recognize this as a reggae song. It's just Bob and his guitar. And this is the last album Bob released while he was alive. And so to have this song at the end, kind of the last message from Bob during his lifetime, is just really special. And it also has a local connection for me. Part of the song, there's a line that says, "Emancipate yourself from mental slavery. Nobody but yourself can free your mind." That's taken from a speech given by Marcus Garvey. And that speech was given right here in Cape Breton, Nova Scotia, a few kilometers away from where I grew up. So that's kind of cool, right? And it's just a great kind of epitaph. No artist has quite wrote his own epitaph the way Bob Marley did here with Uprising. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? Because all I ever had, redemption songs, these songs of freedom. Just a gorgeous song. So number 7, Uprising. Coming in at number 6, we have Rasta Man Vibration, the 4th of the Island records and the 8th overall record from Bob Marley. Came out in 1976 in April. Very interesting kind of time period in Bob Marley's career. He's already a national hero in Jamaica, but is beginning to gain more and more popularity outside of Jamaica. 2 years prior to this, Eric Clapton did the cover of I Shot the Sheriff, which gained them popularity in the US and the UK. But they're also gaining popularity as far away as Japan and, you know, all across the Caribbean and throughout Africa. And he's really emerging as this man of the people, especially across the third world. And in fact, this album is the first and maybe the only, if I'm not mistaken, to break it into the top 10 in both the UK and the US. So musically, what do we have going on? Well, the album starts with Positive Vibration, a nice uplifting start to the album, followed by roots rock reggae, targeted perhaps at the top 40. Great horn section on here, very danceable, great back-to-back tracks to open side A. My favorite is probably the next track on here, Johnny Was. Make sure I didn't miss one here. Yep, Johnny Was. An overlooked Bob Marley track, I think. Maybe not a deep cut, but definitely an overlooked track. And if you're not familiar with it, check it out. It's a very harrowing story of a mother who loses their child in gang-related violence. And yeah, just a really beautiful song. And that flows nicely into the next track, which is Cry to Me, about forgiveness. And I think these kind of flow together really nice. It's actually a re-recording of an old Wailers song from 1966. Very soulful, some great harmonies on here. Just a really nice song. Track side A, rather, ends with the Want More. Great rhythms on here, really nice guitar licks. You think it's the end, but it's just the beginning. Do you want more? Can you think of a better way to end side A? I don't know. It's pretty good. Side B opens with Crazy Bald Heads. I love the scatting that Bob is doing on here. Absolute gold. Deals with kind of the oppressors. Yeah, driving the oppressors out of town. Bald Head being basically anyone who's not Rastafarian. But I think more specifically, anyone who's kind of promoting that colonial system that oppresses one type of people and benefits another type of people, yeah? So driving those out of town. We then have Who the Cap Fits, which talks a lot about the hypocrites and the parasites, probably targeted at the record industry, the producers that Bob had worked with over the years that had done him wrong. And the labels. Night Shift, bit of a forgettable song in my opinion. I think I've read somewhere that this was about his time in the US. He was briefly in the US, worked the night shift, doing some blue collar work, and kind of this is a man of the people kind of song. Don't remember much about it though. The next track, War, is probably the most well-known track off the album. The lyrics of which are taken from Emperor Haile Selassie of Ethiopia, a speech he gave to the United Nations in 1968. I'll just read you a quote here. Until the philosophy which holds one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned, everywhere is war. And I think that speaks to our current time as well with what we have going on around the world. So that song deals with race and class, human rights and peace. Great track. And the rhythm section on here is also really great. The album ends with the song Rat Race, which has a great horn section, kind of a melancholy kind of rhythm, but yet very danceable. Great way to end the album, in my opinion. I like that too. At number five, Kaya. Kaya was released in 1978 in March. It was recorded during Bob Marley's exile in London at the same time that Exodus was recorded. Of course, Exodus would go on to be a huge hit for Bob Marley. And in fact, it was still in the charts when this album was released. It's kind of an interesting album because, you know, when I think about the three kind of personas, I guess, that Bob Marley takes on, you've got Bob Marley, the romantic, who is fully present here on this album, the mystic, or the kind of the spiritual prophet, is here a little bit. But what's really missing from this album is sort of Bob Marley, the rebel. And he got some criticism for that. And I think the next album, Survival, was in some ways a response to that criticism, where it was much more political, much more rebellious in nature, and sort of lacking the sort of love songs that this one has on it. But yet, I still really, really enjoy this. I think there is a really consistency in this album. The rhythm section with Family Man Barrett and Carlton Barrett is just spot on here. And the same with the I3s, their vocal performance. I think consistent is the word that comes to mind here when I listen to this. Thematically, you know, I say we got the love songs on here. We also have a lot of songs about smoking herb and getting elevated. Just some really positive vibrations on this. If you like to sit back and smoke some herb and, you know, just enjoy the music, this is a great album for you. You also have some earthy themes on this album as well. You talk about the sun and the rain and the mist and the herb. And I don't know, overall, I think it has sort of a very earthy, kind of grounding kind of feel to it. And I quite like that when I'm listening to Kaya. Side A is maybe a little bit sunnier than side B. It opens with kind of two back-to-back songs about smoking herb. You've got Easy Skanking, Excuse Me While I Light This Spliff, setting the tone of the album. And the music kind of rhythmically matches that, right? It's kind of a rising rhythm, kind of getting you lifted, which is nice. Kaya, the next track, is a remake of a Lee Perry era track. And what I like about this is it kind of talks about a rainy morning, and you've got that tambourine sound on here, which gives it that nice ambiance. And there's a great bass line on here as well. So yeah, Kaya, great tune. Then you've got like songs like Sun is Shining, which again, a positive song. If you got the rain, now you got the sun, so you get rainbows involved here. But really, I guess it's kind of been a new day is rising. Yeah? It makes you want to move your dancing feet. So it's a very, very fun kind of song. Then you got two love songs on this side as well. You've got Is This Love, my favorite Bob Marley love song. It's just a real sweet song. You know, I want to love you and treat you right. We'll share the shelter of my single bed. Yeah, I dig it. I like it. And then Satisfy My Soul, which was another remake from the Lee Perry era. Don't Rock My Boat. The Barrett brothers are got the rhythms locked in place here as well. And just, you know, a nice love song. We then go into side B. It gets a little bit cloudier. It opens with She's Gone. So another love song, but this time about, you know, she's gone. So it's a sad song, but musically it's nice. You know, it makes you feel good. It's kind of like a blues song in that way. You know, it's a sad song, but it makes you feel good. Then you've got songs like, you know, Misty Morning, which is kind of a mysterious vibe on this one with some sort of philosophical themes. Crisis is an interesting song, because I find unusually it's kind of got an air of ambivalence about it, because it's talking about crises in the world, but, you know, not to worry, just give thanks and praise to Jah. At least maybe I'm not interpreting that right, but I don't know. You then have Running Away, and this is a bit of a callback to another earlier Wailers song, Who Feels It Knows It. Not the same, but, you know, uses that line in here. Great horns on this track. You know, you can't run away from yourself. And then the album ends with Time Will Tell, which I think is an absolutely beautiful song. And it's got those Nyabinga drums, so once again, kind of grounding us. And what I like about this is, after all the positivity on both sides, this one is a bit of a reality check, right? It says, I think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. Time will tell. You know, kind of, yeah, it just kind of smacks you a little bit and, you know, says there's still more to be done. And coming in at number four, I've got Burning. Yeah, this was the second of the Island releases in 1973, and the last album where we had all three of the original Wailers together. Of course, Bunny, Peter, and Bob would all go on to very successful solo careers. And Bob, of course, bringing with him the rhythm section. Rest in peace to Family Man Barrett here, passed away recently. I filmed the other videos previous to this one. But yeah, they did so much for the development of the reggae sound through the 70s, just spectacular. And you can really hear it on this album as well. So, great one. So, yeah, I think this album has a little bit of everything on it. It opens upside A with a anthemic track, really, a protest song, Get Up, Stand Up for Your Rights. That's a very strong opener, right? You can't get much better than that. Also a criticism of the Catholic Church in here as well, with if you know what life is worth, you'd look for yours here on earth, and no more isms, schisms, and so forth. So great song there. We're going to Hallelujah Times, which is a Bunny song, and I gotta tell you, it's so nice to hear Bunny's voice and Peter's voice on this album as well. Yeah, it's just really soulful. Yeah, I really like this, and it's kind of a bit the marching on of time. There's one part at the beginning of the song I really like. Smell the earth been sprinkled by the rain reminds me of useful days. I love the smell of the rain in the summer, and yeah, that just gets me every time. I love it. You got I Shot the Sheriff, another very powerful tune. Of course, it was covered by Eric Clapton, I think a year after the release, and helped to gain a lot of attention to the reggae music, particularly in the US, where that song hit number one. It reached the top 10 in the UK as well. And it's telling the story of being wrongly accused, right? So great song. We then go into Burning and Looting. This is a really powerful song. You know, weeping and wailing tonight. They're talking about they've been suffering for a long, long, long time, and they're burning down illusions tonight. Talk about a song of the disenfranchised. Beautiful song, great rhythm section on here as well. Yeah, great tune. And then we end side A with Put It On, the first of four re-releases of old Wailer songs. Put It On is a kind of a rock steady beat, and I really like that. It's simple, it's joyful. You know, Lord, I thank you. It's talking about no more crying and feeling all right. And I think that's a nice way to end side A. Side B, we've got Small Axe, another re-release. The three big producers in Jamaica got together at the time. Cox and Dodd, Duke Reid, Prince Buster started their own label, kind of dominating, controlling the music industry. And the Wailers' response was, well, if you're the big tree, we're the small axe coming to cut you down, right? That's just a song of the underdog, and I really like that. Yeah, and I like that vocal part, you know, very sharp. You know, that's great. Pass It On, another story for you. Pass It On was penned as far back as 1962 by Bonnie Wailer, and he was supposed to record this in the studio at the same time, apparently, that Bob Marley was recording Judge Not, his first single. And he arrived late to the studio. He was running errands or got caught up at school and things like this. So he never got recorded anyway. So it would be another 9 years until 1971 during the Jad years where he actually recorded this song. And it's a nice song. You know, it's a spiritual song. It's a soulful, talking about togetherness. It's a lovely song, and I think it fits quite well on this album as well. And then we have Dubby Conker, another remake from the Lee Perry days, talking it's a celebratory song. We Free Again, got to reach Mount Zion. Yeah, talking about conquering the negative spirits, right? The oppressor, I think. But yeah, then we have a Peter Tosh song, One Foundation, talking about unity, bringing people together under one common framework, one foundation, if you will. And then we end the album with Rasta Chant, a traditional song. This is probably my favorite track on the album. It's absolutely beautiful, the beautiful drumming in here. talking about, you know, tearing down Babylon and flying to Zion. Beautiful song. We're into the top three now. If you made it this far, thanks for sticking with me. I'm having a lot of fun doing this, so I appreciate you coming along for the journey. All right, coming in at number three, I've got Natty Dread. Bob's essentially his first solo album without Peter and Bunny. He brings in the I-3s for the vocal harmonies that are lost with Bunny and Peter. And yeah, it's just beautiful. He's got something to prove here now, right? He's got to prove that he can make it on his own, that he's an artist without Peter and Bunny. And I think he nails it here. I really do. Let's talk the music. I think side A is a perfect side of music. It's great. It starts off with Lively Up Yourself. And, you know, it's bluesy. This whole album's got a nice blues feel to it, which I really like. You know, the I-3s, as I mentioned, the vocal harmonizing on here is beautiful. The rhythm section's great. You got the horns coming in here. This, from here on in, when Bob Marley's catalog, you start seeing a lot more of the horns. Bob's vocals on here are great. He's doing some scatting, and you can picture him in your mind just skanking around on stage. And how about that sax solo? Even the sax solo is fantastic on here. Then you move into No Woman, No Cry. Great tune. And even though the live version, or the version off the live album, is better, this is still a great song and a great version. So you can't fault it there. You move into Them Bellies Full, rather. Again, the I-3s harmonizing beautifully here. And this is really, you can really see he's hungry, right? Them Bellies Full, but we're hungry. And he's hungry. And it comes through on here. Great bongos, percussions on here. And, you know, Forget Your Troubles and Dance is the line, that the refrain that really hooks you. And unlike some other songs, this feels right, you know? It's how music can heal almost, yeah? It's great. And then closing outside A, you've got Rebel Music, 3 o'clock Roadblock. You got the harmonica in here. I don't know who's playing the harmonica. I tried to check the liner notes. I couldn't see anything. But it's just a great, great tune here. Bob really showing off his vocal range on here. And just a good message as well, right? Like about the day-to-day troubles of surviving in Jamaica at that particular time. Great, great tune. Side B opens up with Soja Say. I like how the horns kind of creep into this one. They kind of start out kind of light, and then they pick up and then get really powerful. Yeah, I really like it. This, you know, another song, a sufferer song about life in the ghetto. Move into the title track, Natty Dread. Real nice feel good rhythm here. You know, Bob is a storyteller, right? Never been to Jamaica, but I feel like I can close my eyes and I can see the streets of Kingston, right? Walking up First Street and Second Street and so forth of Trenchtown, I should say. What else do I have here? The rhythms, the horns, the vocals are all great on here. Don't care what the world say, I and I are going to do things my way, right? This is his way. This is Bob's way. Bend Down Low, this is a re-release from 1967, a ska, rock steady kind of beat here, but update it with cowbells, with keys, with organ, with cymbals, and again, great harmonies on here. You then get Talking Blues, which I think is a fantastic song, probably another one of those underappreciated Bob Marley tunes. It's great harmonica on here. It's a blues song, man. It's got that refrain that goes back to, I don't know, Blind Willie Johnson and Lightning Hopkins. Cold was the ground last night, right? But then he's also got like the preacher lied, and I feel like bombing a church, like really kind of rebellious stuff in here as well. And then it ends with Revolution, which, you know, it's talking about fire and brimstone from Revelations. And this shows Bob as the rebel, and a great way, I think, also to end the album. We're down to two albums left. It's coming in number two. I've got Catch a Fire, their first release with Island from 1973. And it's got this lovely Zippo cover, which is just, how great is that for Catching a Fire? And, you know, I said at the beginning that I'm not going to rank each song or try to get really mathematical about it. I'm just going to go with how the album makes me feel. And something about this one just makes me feel good. You know, it's got Bob, Peter, and Bunny on here, along with the Barrett Brothers. That combination just feels so good. And like we just said with Natty Dread, they had something to prove with this album, right? They were breaking into an international audience, or trying to. And although they didn't really do it with this, it's just a great collection of songs. And whether you've got this version or the Jamaican Tuff Gong version with the extra tracks, you've got, I can't remember the name of the track, give me a second here, All Day, All Night, and High Tide, Low Tide on this. So you get two extra tracks and some different cuts. You know, either version is fantastic. High Tide, Low Tide, highlight of this one. I don't know if I could pick a highlight on here, but I did a whole video comparing and talking about these two albums. I'm going to link that up here, so I'm not going to say anything more about it. For that story, you need to click there. So we've arrived at number one, and it is, of course, Exodus. Bob Marley's masterpiece, in my opinion. Time magazine rated it the greatest album of the 20th century, and I can't disagree. It's a fantastic album, released in 1977, recorded during Bob's exile, self-imposed exile in London after the assassination attempt on his life, recorded along with Kaya at the same time. But Exodus, it plays like a greatest hits album. You know, it's an album of two sides. You know, I've always thought, it actually says part one and part two, right? And I've always kind of thought part one was more of Babylon system, talking about oppression and those sorts of issues. Whereas then you end side one with Exodus, movement of the people leaving Babylon and then going towards Zion. If not in Zion, at least the road to Zion, right? That's kind of the feeling I always got with this album. But wow, what a fantastic, and sound-wise, acoustically, sonically, I should say, sonically, the recording is just brilliant on this. I love it. It starts off with Natural Mystic, and the way it just fades in gives me goosebumps when I listen to it. It, you just crank that up and just let that music hit you. When the music hits, you feel no pain. One good thing about music, I can say that for sure about Natural Mystic. Wow, what a great opening. And the lead guitar here is from Junior Marvin, and it's a spectacular lead guitar on here as well. Then we go into So Much Things to Say. You know, they talks about crucifying Jesus Christ and selling out Marcus Garvey and, you know, killing our prophets, I suppose. And yeah, just a lot of the trials and tribulations of day-to-day survival. But it says, I and I have come to fight flesh and blood. Yeah, so he's here to fight and move through it. Yeah, great, great song. Then we go into Guiltiness, talking about, you know, the down presser's going to eat the bread of sorrow, and they're going to get their upcomings, right? And the same is true of the heathen, right? Same kind of themes, right? But musically, it's just so great. And then we move into Exodus, which is like an opus. Yeah, it's that marching kind of bass line on here, just keeps you marching towards Zion. And then we get into side B, and this is where you get the all the hits that were on. Legend and so forth. You come in with jamming. Just seize it in Mount Zion. It rules all creation, right? So we're not only jamming, but we're celebrating, right? We're moving towards Zion here. And then you've got the love songs, right? You've got Waiting in Vain, followed by Turn Your Lights Down Low. Two beautiful love songs. And while I know I said earlier in the video that Is This Love might be my favorite Bob Marley song, Turn Your Lights Down Low is up there as well. It's a much more mature love song, right? It's more romantic, I think. The other one is more sweet, I think. So yeah, two beautiful songs there. Then we have the Three Little Birds, a nice positive song. Again, connected to the earth, I think. When my children were young, this was the song I would sing to them at bedtime and so forth. So it's a great song as well. And then we end with One Love, People Get Ready, a take off of Curtis Mayfield. That's a very spiritual song. And so is One Love, right? It's about coming together in oneness. And to me, if that's heaven or Zion, there's no greater oneness than that, right? So that's how I interpret it, and I just think it's a beautiful album. Some people say it's overplayed and so forth, but not for me. For me, it is just beautiful. And if I recommend one Bob Marley album to people, it's Exodus.
Right. So, what are your favorite Bob Marley albums? This was not an easy task for me, and if I was to do it again tomorrow, I might even have a different list, but it was a lot of fun to do. I'm going to showcase some more of my Bob Marley collection. I've become a bit of a completist in recent years for Bob Marley. And yeah, so I'm going to show them off this month. So come on back and check those out. Appreciate you spending some time with me if you got this far. One love. Peace.